take all I have in these hands and multiply. God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, well, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide. Thank you.
morning, everyone. Welcome to LeClaire. Why don't y'all stand with us today? We're so excited to get worship going here in just a second, but we just want to say thank you guys for joining us this morning here in person and on the stream. Thank you guys so much for joining us here at LeClaire. We're going to get things going, but let's bow our heads and say a prayer today before we do. Father God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here together, to just be here in worship, and just be here in community, God, and to be here just studying who you are and your character, Father. And we just ask that you would flood this place with your presence this morning, God. We want you to be in this place more than anything, God, and as we leave this place, we want to carry you with us. So flood this place today. We invite you here this morning. Thank you for your son, and in his name we pray. Amen. Join me in worship today.
Sometimes on this journey, get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. It's feel you won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Feel you won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh. Check your shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Oh, you're in the Father's house now.
Arrival's not the end game.
Arrival's not the end game. Journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. Cause failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Oh no, failure's never final when the Father's in the room. ourselves. Oh. And in the Father's house, check your shame at the door. It ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Everybody, go ahead and have a seat this morning. Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see your faces today. If you don't know me, my name is Daniel. I'm the discipleship minister here at LeClaire, and I'm excited to be with you and continuing in this series that we have been a part of. Now, when my wife and I were first dating, we had a pretty easygoing relationship. We seemed to agree on everything. In fact, I can't even remember anything that we fought about during that season. And so shortly after we were married, when we're learning to live together and having those first conflicts, they seemed like a much bigger deal than they probably were. So big that I can remember some of the things that we argued about. And one of those, I remember we were out to eat on a Friday night, and we were talking about what we were going to do over the weekend. Now, both of us at the time worked full-time, and so Saturday was our day to do what we wanted to do. And so for me, I am a task-oriented person, and I thought, this is the perfect day to just start knocking things off my to-do list. I'm going to wake up early and just tackle it and just see how much we can get done. But for Kelsey, it's the opposite. She was like, well, no, this is my day. I've been working all week. I want to sleep in and not have any responsibilities on my plate. And so we were talking about it, and she's like, so in the morning, you know, what time are you planning to get up? And I was like, I don't know, I was thinking around like 7 or so. And she's like, but you're not going to set your alarm, right? I said, well, yeah, I want to get up early so I can get all these things done. And so we kept going back and forth, and it kind of got heated. And I was like, are you really telling me that, like, I can't get up whenever I want to get up? And it's about that moment that I learned in marriage, I may not always get the things that I want. And that's the reality. And of course, then later in life, we had kids, and so nobody had anything they wanted to do on Saturday, and that's how that works. But you'll learn in marriage or in any relationship or in society, we can't just get everything that we want. That this is not true freedom. And as we talk about life and liberty, liberty cannot be defined as simply getting to do whatever you want, because this does not work. I mean, take, for example, the book of Judges. This is a great book that helps display this. You have God's people who have recently been delivered. They've gone through the wilderness. They're now in a land of their own, so they don't have to rely on God for all their physical needs like they did. But we begin to see this philosophy creep in with them, and we see it repeated throughout the book. It says that everyone did as he saw fit. But what did that lead to? It led to chaos. And so God then would have to raise up another judge, another person to set them straight and to remind them that he was the one who set the ultimate standard that gave ultimate freedom. And this is exactly what Andy unpacked last week as we started this series. And if you didn't get a chance to go back and listen to that message, I encourage you to do so. Because he reminded us that truth cannot be defined by ourselves. As human beings, we are imperfect. Jeremiah 17 tells us that the human heart is deceitful above all things. And so for this reason, we cannot define truth apart from God. If we do that, it leads to chaos. And that's why we landed on last week that the truest form of freedom has to be found in the truest form of truth. And that cannot come from within ourselves. It has to come from a standard that does not change. You see, throughout history and throughout different societies and as attitudes and morals shift and change, God's truth remains the same. And we see it unpacked throughout the pages of scriptures in his commands and ultimately fulfilled in the person and the work of Jesus. Now, that's what we talked about last week. And so we talked about that we can find true freedom in the truest form of truth. And so if we talked about where we can find that last week, today I want us to dig a little deeper and talk about what is that truest form of truth. Because I think once we know this, it completely changes our perspective on life and liberty. And once we discover this true freedom and what it is, why would we settle for, why would we advocate for, or why would we fight for anything less? So if you have your Bibles, we're going to be where we were last week in John chapter 8. You can go ahead and get there on your mobile devices. We'll read here in just a moment. Now, we love freedom, and we long to protect freedom and fight for freedom. I mean, who doesn't like freedom? But I think, as is often the case, we can get easily distracted into advocating for a version of freedom that is subservient to the type of freedom that Jesus describes in our passage. You see, I've seen many people devote their lives to campaigning for freedoms that, when compared to the freedom that Jesus describes, can be so trivial. The freedom that Jesus speaks of does not come from choosing the right candidate on election day. It doesn't come from a constitution or any document that guarantees such freedoms. It can exist in a country that touts itself to be the freest of all other countries. But it can also exist in a country that is ruled by some of the most totalitarian leaders and Christians, men and women, who are a part of the kingdom of God and experiencing this true freedom. They have existed under both conditions and experienced that freedom because their identity is found in a greater citizenship, in a kingdom that supersedes all others. You see, this freedom can exist in the United States, or in England, or in Canada. It can also exist in China, and Iran, and Venezuela, and North Korea. True freedom has little to do with earthly governments, or who is in charge, or who is in the Supreme Court, or who rules the Senate, or the House of Representatives, or who is on the school board, or who is on the eldership at church, but it has everything to do with who is on the throne in heaven. And that appointment was confirmed 2,000 years ago. There's no vote for it. It's never going to go vacant, and the term lasts into eternity. Now, in our passage, Jesus shares a lesson with this group of Jews that he is talking about. And this group was convinced that they knew what true freedom was and they were experiencing true freedom because they were God's people, after all. And they knew he had the power over all other nations. He had rescued them from the people of Egypt, and throughout their history, he had rescued them from other nations, from the Assyrians and the Babylonians, and they had witnessed this. Now, of course, there were moments that because of their disobedience and their wayward actions, God did allow some other nations to take them over politically. But even in these seasons, they never lost their identity, and they never felt that they were slaves to anyone, because ultimately they knew that their God was the one true God, and that's all that they had to serve. And they were right to an extent. But they were misguided on something. They were misguided on what the real threat was. See, somehow in their knowledge of God and who he was and what he had done for them, they were blinded to the most dangerous enemy, the greatest enslaver and the greatest thief to our freedom. It wasn't another nation. It wasn't another political party, and they had plenty themselves. It wasn't the king that was in their region that claimed to be one of them, but really didn't look like anything like them, and it wasn't some other oppressive government that they were facing. No, it was something much worse. And here, Jesus makes clear theirs and our greatest threat. And just like his audience, I think that our enemy today would love nothing more than to convince us into believing that our greatest threat is something different than what it truly is. So in John chapter 8, Jesus is speaking to these Jews, and they are on the tail end of this festival in Jerusalem. Now, throughout the years, the Jews celebrated these various festivals to remind themselves of their history, and this one was called the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, that's not one that we often talk about. Well, you know, we'll talk about Passover when we get to the Easter season, but this was a really important feast. In fact, one of the most prominent Jewish historians, a man by the name of Josephus, described this feast. He says this is the most holy and most important of all their feasts. And how they would celebrate is they would flock to Jerusalem, Jews from around the area, and it was a time to remember the season where they were wandering in the desert. The very first moment in their history where they were finally free from the Egyptians. So you have to know that freedom and independence and their identity was on their mind. And during that season, back in their history, you know, they would wander throughout the wilderness. They'd have to set up in tents and be ready to go right when God said it was time to go. And so to commemorate that, they would basically set up tents around the city just to remember that. So it's kind of like a glorified camping trip. It doesn't sound super fun to me, but I'm sure for many of you that seems like that would be a fun week-long festival. So we'll jump in into our text, chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. To the Jews who had believed in him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." So here we see where we find true freedom. It's in the truth. It's in the truth that Jesus provides in an abiding in him. But they were confused on this because, remember, they thought they were free. They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants, and we've never been slaves to anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" You see, they assumed they were experiencing the greatest freedom. They were God's people, after all. So who is this guy to tell them that they weren't free? And Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who has even one time gone against God's command, everyone who sins is a slave to sin." See, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what party you're in or what leader you're under. Jesus is saying to all of them that you might think that you are free, but the reality is, if you sin, you are not. And this is the same reality that you and I face today. If there is any longing for a freedom that we should have on our hearts, it should be for this one. If there's any hierarchies of freedoms, this is the greatest one, because it has implications not just for this world, but for the one to come and into eternity. And for this reason, we must never become convinced that any politic or any philosophy or any activism or any earthly authority or country or societal class that we're born into can somehow absolve us of this problem, because it cannot. None of those things are solutions. And so many of the things that we fight for or fight against don't truly get to the main problem. But it was Jesus' desire that his followers would experience true freedom. But to do this, here in this passage, he reminds them of two important truths. The first is this: the realization of sin in our lives is the entry point to true freedom. The realization of sin in our lives is the entry point to true freedom. You see, sin is the root of all human oppression and pain and suffering that we face on earth. But even more tragic is that it is the root of why there are countless men and women who are destined to live an eternity apart from God unless something changes. And so often we lose sight of this, and we fight for things that make no difference in helping people realize this problem, or we fight for things that actually make the problem worse because it distracts from the root, and the root is sin. We cannot lose sight of this. You see, for all of those who are in the kingdom of God and experiencing the freedoms that we have in the kingdom of God, all of us have come to a conclusion prior to that, that we do not deserve to be in the kingdom of God. This is where we have to start if we're going to find true freedom. We have to realize that we are under a burden far too great for us, that we are enslaved to a master that is too strong for us to overthrow on our own. And if we, or those in this world, become convinced that we don't have a problem, that we can find true freedom and fulfillment in other ways, then we won't seek out the right solution. And if you and I forget the main problem, then we will stop telling people about the only solution. And without that solution, this world and the people in it will never experience true peace and true liberty. Listen, it is not wrong to fight for a just society. It is not wrong to vote for people and to be educated on what's going on, to see a just society be created. I believe there's a biblical precedence for this. But in our fight for a just society, if we fail to lead people to the truth of the reality of their own sinfulness, we have failed. We will fail at the mission of the good news of the gospel. And just like Jesus' audience, sometimes we get confused on who the true enemy is. You see, these Jews, they were convinced that because of who they were and who they were born into, the country that they were a part of, the people group that they were a part of, that they were truly free. They had this idea that being right with God was somehow bound up in their political and ethnic identity. Now, even though they had the morals and the commands of God given through their history, they still saw those outside of their group as unable to be in a relationship with him. They were enemies of God and pagans. And Jesus comes to help them see the true reality, to remind them that God had set this group of people apart for a purpose, and it wasn't just to exist as God's people forever and to cut everyone else out, but to extend this blessing of being God's people to everyone else in the world, every nation and tribe and people group. That was their role. They were to bring about this Messiah, and now God had delivered on that, and the Messiah was now here, and he was trying to explain to them who he truly was. I mean, just a handful of verses earlier, he tells them, "I am the light of the world." But they just weren't grasping. They weren't grasping it. So Jesus helped them see that all along, these laws that Moses had given them, laws that they trusted in as their salvation, that was not their original intent. But they were a tool to teach all of humanity about the nature of sin, about this main problem. The laws that Moses gave were used as a way of revealing our failures and pointing to us the true problem. But even these had their limits, because sin was not simply about breaking a list of rules or keeping a list of rules. It went much deeper than that. This was just a tool to point us to a reality that so often we fail to love God in a way that gives him the honor that he deserves. And we fail to love people who have been made in God's image. We fail to give them the honor that they deserve because they are creations of God. This law points to how we fail at loving God and loving others. And so this is why Jesus said, you know, it's more than just do not murder, but it's understanding that our hearts are bent towards anger and retaliation when people do us wrong. It's more than just don't commit adultery, but it's a realization that our hearts are prone to wonder and lust after people in ways that demean them as people who are made in the image of God. And when we can finally come to terms with this failure and the responsibility that we have in this, then in our humility and in our brokenness, our eyes are open to the only solution. I mean, if you were to trace human history, sin has always been our greatest enemy. From the very first generation of people, it was sin that brought in death and destruction into this world. And then you go to the very next generation, you have these two brothers, and God defines it even more as Cain is jealous of his brother, and God says, listen, hold up. Sin is crouching at your door. This is where you have a choice to make. And he describes sin as like this animal that's getting ready to prowl and overtake you. But what does Cain do? He chooses to sin. And everyone from generation to generation to generation has done the very same thing. And now we find ourselves in a prison that we cannot escape on our own. This is our greatest problem. And Satan would love nothing more to convince us that we don't have a problem. We see evidence of this all over the place. One of the main ways we see this is a lot of what Andy talked about yesterday, or last week, about how sometimes we, you know, try to create our own truth, and we feel that we can live by a standard that we create, that somehow the Bible is antiquated and it needs to progress to our standards. In every society and in every culture throughout time, we see this pattern as people begin to normalize things that go against our ability to love God and love others in the proper ways, maybe even legalizing those things. And we think to ourselves, oh, it's not hurting anybody else, so surely it's okay. Or maybe we see, no, it's infringing on my right to do X, Y, and Z, and so I've got to be able to do X, Y, and Z, so it's okay. And this can end up leading to some truly horrific things, because sin always leads to the same place, to death and destruction. All because, like these Jews, we become blind to the real problem. Is this not a symptom of humanity's hearts wandering from the reality of sin? Another way that we get distracted from this real problem is it's so easy to blame all of our problems on maybe some other person or some other group. And we spend all of our effort to destroy what we think is the true enemy, when Paul tells us that our fight is not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And in our actions and in our anger, we end up, instead of fighting what we think is the true enemy, falling prey to him once again. And in our blaming, it's all too easy to dismiss our own culpability. Can you see how the enemy works? If he can get us distracted from the real problem, then we won't be looking for the real solution. But Jesus says, everyone who sins. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if we're not careful, slowly over time, we become blind to a truth that we cannot fail to see, that sin is our greatest enemy and it's entrapped us all. And the realization of sin in our lives is the entry point to true freedom. But we can't stop there. And Jesus doesn't stop there. He goes on. This is what he says in verse 35. Because now we have the problem, there's got to be a solution. He says, now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. See, Jesus, again, is alluding to who he is. He's alluding to his authority, that he is God's son. He's the only one with the authority to emancipate people from their slavery of sin. So first, we have to recognize the reality of our sin, but we can't stop there. And I think far too often in the church, there are so many people that have turned their backs on God because they've only gone that far. They've stopped there. They see the church as a place that's super judgmental, that all we ever do is talk about sin. But the reality is we have the answer to that sin, and we're the only ones that have the answer to that sin. So we have to remember the second truth, which is this, that we will never find true freedom until the burden of sin is taken from us through Jesus. We will never find true freedom until that burden of sin is taken from us through Jesus. Romans 6, 17 to 18, but thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. Through Christ, we gain truth. When we accept him by faith and abide in his way, we are set free from sin. In his commentary, Mark Moore talks about what it is that Jesus does for us when we choose to follow him in faith. He says that first and foremost, that we are saved from the penalty of sin. This means that the moment we choose to follow him, our debt is canceled and we are declared righteous before God. That even when our emotions might betray us and might convince us that we're continual failures, we can stand on the truth that there is no longer any condemnation. Not only that, but he saves us from the practice of sin. That through the Holy Spirit living in us, we grow increasingly sanctified, meaning we grow increasingly like Christ, and we have the ability to overcome our sinful habits. And lastly, he saves us from the power of sin. That we are given new hearts, new hearts that desire him in an increasing measure. And the more that we desire him, the less we will desire the sin that still longs to entrap us again. And when we accept this solution, when we are born again into this new kingdom, when we realize that we now are slaves only to the one true God, that he is the king, he is the creator of the universe, that we are free in relation to every other man and to every other human structure that we see here on earth, then in that freedom, God sends us to live in this world, to live under various governments, to live within different families, to live in different workplaces where there is speed limits and taxes and time clocks. But because we know that we have true freedom, we could submit to these things, not because we are slaves to any other person, but because we are slaves to the one true God, and we are doing it to honor and serve him. And no matter what difficulties we face, we can face them because we know who we serve. This is true freedom. And it comes from realizing our own sin and then recognizing and accepting the only solution. You see, these Jews, they celebrated the fact that they had freedom because they served God, and that had changed their perspective. And God had set them free in various ways. But then he did it again for us in the greatest possible way, freeing us from our greatest enemy, and that completely changes our perspective. Now, Jesus told us that in this world there would be trouble, and we can't escape that. There is still sin in this world, and for that reason, there will always be poverty. There will always be sickness. There will always be oppression, but the Bible teaches us that the earth itself is groaning because of the sin that is in it. But we have a solution. We have a solution for ourselves to experience peace and contentment and freedom. And we have a solution that can help others experience those same things, so we can never lose sight of this. So no matter what evil may come, we are free. And we may only get to experience that partially now, but we have a hope that we will experience it fully one day in heaven. This world is not all there is. So no matter who wins in November, no matter who holds the majority in Congress, we as Christians can hold fast to the knowledge that through Jesus we have been given true freedom, and that freedom cannot be taken away by anyone. And who the Son sets free will be free indeed. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful and rejoice at the freedom that we have in you, that we have been fortunate enough to be able to find the truest truth. I pray that you would place a burden on our lives to continue to break the chains of our greatest enemy in this world around us, that you would empower us to speak the truth, to live the truth. Help us to submit where we need to submit and to stand up where we need to stand up, and ultimately to do all of that because we are servants of you, and you are the creator of the universe. In you is all things that is good, all things that are true. We are so grateful for how you love us. Help us to do the same with others. It's in your name we pray. Amen. This is the time in our service where we have communion. So hopefully on your way in, you grabbed one of those little cups. If you missed that, there's a table right out there. Feel free to run and grab one of those. But this is the time every single week where we remember this ultimate truth. And you've got this little piece of bread and this juice that is a symbol of the price that Jesus paid for our ultimate freedom. Romans 6 phrases it this way: "For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, and we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. And each week we remember, we identify with that death, with that decision we made to die to our old selves and take on this new life, being slaves to God alone. So today, as you take communion, as you eat, and as you drink, let's eat and drink to the true freedom that we have in Christ.
Come to the Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Well, thank you all so, so very much for joining us today. To everybody who joined us online, thank you so much. We know that we have had a little bit of a technical difficulty with one of our online platforms today, but we're working to get all that figured out for next week. But man, before we dismiss, I just want to just reiterate what Daniel said, man. In Jesus, we are free indeed. Man, that's some good news for us today. I have a few announcements to make before we dismiss. The first one is, as many of you know, over the past few weeks, we have been collecting food for the Glen Ed Food Pantry. And today is the last day that we are collecting food. But beginning next week, we're going to start another outreach kind of giveaway thing. And what we're asking is that if any of you have any old but gently used winter coats, we're partnering with an organization to give away some winter coats to local families in the area. We'll collect them from next Sunday all the way through November the 8th. And also next Sunday, we have one of our Discover LeClaire classes. So if you're new to LeClaire, or maybe you've been attending for a little while, but you're just ready to take that next step in getting a little bit more plugged in here at LeClaire, this class is for you. I mean, it's a chance for you to come and ask whatever questions you have, to learn more about what we believe and why we do what we do. And the class will take place next Sunday at 10 o'clock in the hearth room here at the church. However, if you've been watching online and you want to take that next step and you're not ready to yet come back in person, please email daniel@leclairecc and we'll figure out a time to meet with you online to talk to you all about LeClaire. Today is also the last day to nominate elders and deacons for the church leadership at LeClaire. And back at the back of the auditorium, you will notice some black boxes. If you would like to give your tithes and your offerings here in person, you can put them in that black box, in the black boxes. Or if you have a nomination form you would like to submit, you can put them in those boxes as well. And then finally, if you're a guest here with us today, thank you so very much for spending a part of this beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning with us. It really means the world to us that you would be here. And if you would stop by our Welcome Center in the lobby, we have a gift for you today just to say thanks for being here. But right now, I'm going to pray, and then we'll be dismissed. My Father in heaven, I thank you so much for the way that you love us. Jesus, I thank you for the freedom that you've given us. And Father, I pray that as we leave this place, that we will experience that freedom every single day of our lives, God. That we will not live as slaves to our sin, but we will live free in you. So will you please go before us and behind us? Will you surround us with your presence, with your peace, with your comfort, with your wisdom? And Father, we need you. So will you bless us and keep us and shine your face upon us? Will you be gracious to us and give us rest and peace? We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. We'll see you guys next week for part 3 of Life and Liberty.